So I don't normally do this, but the second reading requires just a little bit of attention before I move on to the main portion of my text. It's the takeaway is that Paul thinks you should all be vegetarians, which I understand is very healthy for you. So, but I want to give this text just a little bit more context because one, it's got like 1,000 words and very awkwardly ordered and feels like it needed maybe 200 words to say the same thing. But I'm gonna change a couple of the words in a way that's probably not recommended by my Greek teacher, but I think it'll be easier for us to understand. If we talk about meat being sacrificed at the temple, I think if instead of the word sacrificed, we use the word barbecued, we would be a bit closer to what we're dealing with here. We have an image of a major festival. We think of all these towns like Corinth and other places where there would be temples to all different kinds of deities and idols. And occasionally there would be festivals where meat that had been offered at the temple would be made available to those who were there celebrating or observing the festival. Paul kind of moves through this and says, you know, and I know, that these idols aren't really a thing. And so for us to have some of this barbecue is not a big deal theologically, but it's possible that those who are newer to the faith, new in their life in Christ, might be confused if they saw you eating this meat at the temple, and it might cause them to lose their faith or lose their way. Because of that, I will abstain from the meat. Now, if you're thinking that is the big lesson of the day, it's not quite. But the thing that I think is interesting here is the idea that other people around us and in our communities and the people in our own homes, the people that we interact with at school or work, that they have some demand on how we behave and move through this life, how we interact and help one another. For crying out loud, use turn signals. I mean, we think of all of the ways in which we can help one another, right? Or at least not distract or cause people to drift away. Now, when we have three readings on a Sunday, first reading, second reading, gospel text, often the first reading and the gospel text go together pretty well. We hear in the Old Testament reading from Deuteronomy about a prophet that is coming, and then we get a story in the gospel of Jesus teaching in the synagogue as a prophet in some fashion. So we get this kind of tying together here. But I think there is a thread that goes through all three of these readings, even. The idea of what kind of outside claims are there on us. A text that we get in the gospel is the use of the word authority. Authority generally isn't our most favorite of words. This idea of who has authority over us? There's a house about three or four doors down from where we live that has a big flag out front that says, "Don't tread on me," which I haven't met them. I don't think they mean me specifically. But the image, though, of this idea that somehow there are outside forces that are in positions of authority over us. Now, if we're driving too fast on the freeway and a car comes up behind us with a siren on, suddenly that's a person with a lot of authority over us in that moment, right? Not authority we would necessarily choose, but we have the opportunity to be under it living in the United States as we do. This image of authority. But when we think of Jesus, that sense of authority is perhaps a little different. It's an authority that we are voluntarily under, that we choose to be under. It's a little bit more along the lines of what we get in the second reading for today with all of that confusing language about meat at the temple. This idea that we choose to live in a different way, that we choose to live under Christ's authority. Now, there was a phrase in my house that I'm sure was unique to the home that I grew up in, but as an older sibling, I would hear from my younger brother when we were little often, "You're not the boss of me," right? Now, as the older brother, I thought, yeah, well, actually, I kind of am. So that's, but many of us can relate with that image, right? This idea of trying to get out from under. But at the same time, in our lives of faith, there is this sense of this voluntary authority of Christ. In the gospel text, it says, they were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one having authority. You could almost understand it to mean he taught as one having his own authority. Someone who maybe said, I tell you, would have been a very different way of teaching, a way in which Jesus was directly expressing the will of God to us. Now, we use that word authority. In fact, even in the liturgy that we have today, we began with confession. And Pastor Friederike, towards the end of it, as we move towards absolution, said, as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I declare to you the forgiveness of all your sins. This word authority, we have kind of complicated relationship with the word authority. It kind of comes like along with the word of responsibility or obligations or things like that. Not our favorite set of words, generally speaking. But I think in this week with these texts, it's maybe a little bit of a call to us to kind of walk through this life and be asking ourselves, who is the boss of us, right? Who do we listen to? Who do we look to for authority? Certainly there are perhaps secular examples of this. We might think of teachers or others. But what does it mean in our lives of faith when we talk about Christ having authority over us? Is it like human authority, which makes us think of cars and sirens or other kinds of authority? Often it is an authority over, right? It is the ability to take away from or diminish or restrain in some fashion. Is that the authority that we understand through the Gospels in Christ? The authority of Christ is to kind of buck those human authorities. It is to reach out to those who are hungry and feed them without asking whether they were working this last week or not, or healing those who are sick and injured without asking them why they don't have insurance. It's all kinds of ways in which Christ reaches out in ways that are costly. Ultimately, costly like a cross. So what does it mean to be voluntarily under Christ's authority? And how does that inform the way in which we move through this life? I guess I would encourage you as you go through this week until we get to next Sunday's set of readings, to be asking yourself, what does it mean for Christ to have authority in your life? Amen.